No, today we will be discussing about most importantly are the two parasitic or ectoparasitic infestations in humans. Okay, so ectoparasitic infections are the most common type of cutaneous infestations which are usually present over our skin, and most commonly they will be present as the symptom of itch in your day-to-day dermatology OPD. Secondly, the ectoparasitic infections are also common because they are indicator of our socioeconomic status, cleanliness, and also it is an indicator of living standard because overcrowding, dirty living standards, okay. And others. Hello, हाँ पवन, आई विल कॉल यूर क्लास क्लास ले रखा थोड़ा कॉल. सो डर्टी लिविंग स्टैंडर्ड्स एंड ड्यू टू द डिक्रीज इन हेल्थ एंड हाइजीन, ऑल दिस फीचर्स विल लीड टू So all these features will lead to scabies. So now we will start the classes. Okay, first we will discuss about scabies. Now scabies, as we all know, is a cutaneous manifestation caused by the scabies mite. Okay, so what is scabies basically? It is nothing but it's a very itchy rash caused by a parasitic mite that burrows into the skin surface. Okay, so scabies is a itch mite, or common name is itch mite. And what itch mite is doing, basically it is burrowing through the skin. Okay, it will go through the, this is the itch mite, you can see, and these are the eggs. Okay, so this mite is burrowing through the skin. So when it, the movement of the mice is happening, it is causing itching in the skin. Now the scientific name for scabies mite in humans is Sarcoptes scabivar hominis. Other variants of scabies are also there. Animal scabies is one of the common conditions which you were able to see. It is caused by animal species, like suppose dog scabies, or from cats, or from cattle. So different species of scabies, Sarcoptes scabivar mite, are there. But in humans, that hominis variant is a obligate ectoparasite in human body. Now scabies mite usually infestation is by direct contact. So the infestation happens when suppose somebody is having scabies and you are getting in contact with that person. So what happens, that scabies mites transfer to your body and you get the infection. When infection happens, after the infection the male dies after mating. So when male and female mites both are present over your body, they start mating and the male mite dies. Then what happens, that female mite burrows into epidermis. So here we can see some photos. Here we can see this male is mating with the female and the male is dying off. Then it is giving rise to, because it is a oviparous organism, it lays up to 3 to 4 eggs. Okay, and it moves through the epidermis. Here we can see it is a high power microscopic feature, scanning microscope of skin. The male has mated and it has died off. Now this female mite is, you can see it is going into the keratin layer of the epidermis. Okay, here the female mite, it burrows and it lays the eggs. Okay, so eggs are usually 3 to 4 eggs per mite are developed, and the duration after mating and production of mate eggs are around 10 to 14 days. Now after this production of eggs, again the mite will come out and the cycle will again continue until unless any interruption happens in the cycle. Now transmission of scabies, most importantly transmission is through skin contact of a infected person. So it is very commonly seen in very crowded places, like suppose in armies, okay, people who are staying in hostels, then jail inmates, then school kids, where lot of people are staying in close proximity. So what happens, from one person to another this mite transfers. And as per contrary to our belief, usually indirect transfer, like somebody has slept on your bed and somebody had scabies and then you go and sleep, so you chances of getting scabies to you is less as compared to direct contact with a infected person, because the thing is that the scabies mite is an obligate parasite. For it to survive more than some 24 to 48 hours outside human body is not possible. So usually the transmission is not by clothes, it's by direct contact. Now symptoms can be divided into three different parts, that is first is itch, second is rash, and third is hypersensitivity reaction. So itching, characteristically we can tell it is a nocturnal itching, okay, most commonly at night. It will happen once the female mite starts to burrow through the skin. So it is most characteristically severe at night, and it will involve the parts wherever flexural regions are there, like over the, just see the diagram, flexural areas like here in the axilla and around the armpit, then here in the folds, here we can see in the wrist, okay, around the genitals, okay, over abdomen and periumbilical region, okay, posteriorly over the buttocks. So all these flexural lesions, even on sometimes on neck, the mites will be surviving because they try to hide in the folds of the skin. And usually you will see in the males the shaft of penis is also involved, okay. So first symptom is itch, and itching is very severe at night. It is so severe that patient is not able to bear the itch, and it makes him awake at the night. And the characteristic is that it will seldomly involve the scalp, and it will seldomly involve the face. And we should remember, in cases of scabies, even after treatment, even after the mite is dead, itching will be present for at least, you can say, 2 to 3 weeks, because of the hypersensitivity reaction. If the mite dies off due to treatment, still it is in the skin until unless it is shed by our body, the hypersensitivity reaction keeps on happening and itching will be present. Now second symptoms, that is characteristic lesion of scabies, is burrows. Burrows are nothing but 0.5 to 1.5 centimeter irregular tracts in the web spaces. Okay, I'll show some burrows. Here we can see characteristic, see this irregular tract is there, and at the end of the burrow some papules will be present where the mite is residing. So burrows are irregular tracts basically present over the flexural parts like armpits, buttocks, over the web spaces of finger, insteps of heels, then over the penis, okay, around the umbilicus. So all these flexural lesions, these burrows will be present. So burrows is usually having a serpiginous or snail like track. It is not a straight track, it is a serpiginous or serpent like track. So when the mite is digging in your skin, it creates the burrows and it will go deep inside the epidermis and will rest there. So the burrow is a, we can say it is a characteristic lesion of a scabies infection. Now third is rash. Now what happens, people will think only burrows will be present in scabies, but as we all know, scabies is caused by a ectoparasite. Now this ectoparasite is known to produce hypersensitivity reaction in our skin. Okay, so it is known to produce hypersensitivity reaction in our skin. Now, various kind of hypersensitivity reaction which is present in scabies are something like is diffuse dermatitis or nummular eczema. Then it can give rise to articarial lesions, multiple articarial, that is papular articaria can also be present. Apart from it, sometimes vesicular lesions can be present. And acropustulosis. Acropustulosis is nothing but sterile pustules present over the palms and soles. Then large papules, if long standing scabies is there, the small papules will change into nodules, giving rise to nodular scabies. And usually it is most commonly seen in males, that is present over the scrotum, around the shaft of the penis and armpits and groins. Okay. And in cases of immunocompromised patients like HIV positive or some severely malnourished children, scabies involve all the areas including face and the skull. So here few of the lesions, see how the burrows are present. Scabies burrows, here burrows. Now here it is very characteristic lesion, we can see a small papule is there and track, you see the track is somewhat serpiginous. At the end of the track one papule is present where the mite lies. Okay, now we have discussed about various complications of various symptoms of scabies, and we have seen the various lesions, that is burrows and rash of the scabies. Here you can see. Now complications, here one patient that is very characteristically, most common complications of scabies is crusted scabies. So see in this patient what is happening, there is thickening of the folds or the inside of the fingers. There is thickened plaque is present and white crust powdery material is present. So this thickening and crusting is basically due to infestation of scabies mite in an exaggerated manner. Now mostly you will see in mentally ill patients who are residing in asylum or chronically ill patients who are neglected at home, especially roadside beggars. Also you can see in immunocompromised patients like bed bound patients. Suppose somebody is infected with HIV, somebody is having uncontrolled diabetes mellitus. So this kind of condition will be present where there is millions of mites will be present throughout the body. And the one characteristic finding you will see in crusted scabies is lack of itching. Usually the patient will complain that itching is not as severe as in normal or other cases of scabies is there, because of the repeated assaults of this hypersensitivity reaction. Crusting and thickening leads to decrease in sensitivity, okay, or desensitization will be there. Now apart from crusting, we can see also secondary infection is also there. So obviously if there is scabies, burrows and lesions are there, there are chances of exogenous infection by bacterial, commensal bacteria of our skin. So staphylococcal or streptococcal infections are quite commonly seen in patients suffering from scabies, specifically in pediatric age group, where children tends to scratch the lesions too much, giving rise to abrasions and leading to secondary infection. Now diagnosis of scabies is essentially based on three different things. Now diagnostic criteria has been proposed, that is, one is presence of microscopical features, then presence of clinical features, and then presence of history. So this diagnostic criteria has been proposed nowadays, but essentially we have to remember the diagnosis of scabies is basically history and clinical examination. Now in history, most importantly is presence of itch or nocturnal itch is a characteristic feature in diagnosis of scabies. Second thing, history of similar kind of complaints in family and contact history. Suppose somebody has traveled somewhere, or some people have traveled to their home, or some kids are having similar kind of complaints in family, give rise to a strong suspicion of scabies, because we all know it is a communicable disease by close contact. Now history also involves presence of clinical presence of typical lesions distributed over typical sites, that is present over the groin or present over the shaft of the penis or present over the arms or axilla or inframammary region in females. So all these areas, if patient gives a history that itching is nocturnal, all these areas are involved, then obviously our doubt goes towards scabies. Then one more test we can do is to see the burrows. Here we can see the burrows are outlined. So how burrows we can see is by simply by a test, that is methylene blue test. So simply you paint methylene blue and wash the hands. So what will happen, the methylene blue will go inside the burrows, and after washing the hands it will remain in the burrow. So when you visualize directly under a hand lens, you will be able to see the tract in methylene blue stained blue color. So this is a very easy bedside test to identify the burrow. Apart from it, Wood's lamp examination you can do. What you can do, you can apply tetracycline ointment over the folds of the finger and then wash it off. Now tetracycline is have a yellowish fluorescence under Wood's lamp, that is 365 nanometer of UV lamp. So when you put Wood's lamp, you will be able to see fluorescence along the tract of the burrows, because tetracycline goes and lies inside the tract, which is not easily washed off by water. Apart from it, direct microscopy is obviously is a definitive diagnosis. Direct microscopy, we can visualize the mite. Here we can see how direct microscopy we are able to see the mite. See, direct microscopy, we can see the mite burrowing into the epidermis. So direct microscopy is confirmatory diagnosis actually. So direct microscopy we can do. Apart from it, nowadays dermatoscopy is there. Dermatoscope is a instrument something like ophthalmoscope or otoscope. So you put it over the skin lesion and see a low power microscopic view. So specific, you can see the tunneling lesions giving rise to a characteristic what is like, look like that, that is hand glider like appearance will be seen. That is a characteristic lesion of scabies. And obviously skin biopsy is the definitive diagnosis. When you will do skin biopsy, you will be able to see the burrows as well as the mites and eggs in the burrows. So these are all few of the tests. Most important history, then methylene blue test, Wood's lamp examination, microscopic examination. Microscopic examination, what we do, we take a scraping from the burrows and we mount it in a oil mount slide with oil mount, and we see under high power microscope. Okay, so these are the ways we can identify the mite in our body. So this is a diagnostic criteria. I'm just given it because it is diagnostic criteria proposed by the internal conscious scabies consensus society, but need not to be read by you because it is not required for your level. Now treatment of scabies. See, all scabies treatment is basically depend upon some antiparasitic agents. So most of the antiparasitic agents are or either organophosphorus or some neurotoxic poisons, which are neurotoxin to the mite nervous system. So most commonly you can use his permethrin, that is 5% permethrin cream, which has to be applied below the neck, specifically over the affected regions, and kept all overnight and washed in the morning. So permethrin, what is called, it's called a blockage of the acetylcholine receptors, leading to respiratory failure in the mite, leading to death of the mite. Apart from it, we also can give aqueous malathion lotion. Okay, oral ivermectin also, it's a very common antiparasitic agent acting in same manner. It is acting as a neurotoxic poison for the mite. So 2200 microgram per kg body weight can be given in two doses, that is one dose today and one dose after 1 week, because we know the hatching period of mite is around 7 to 10 days. So if any eggs which are about to be hatched, so repeat treatment has to be done after 7 days. Now benzoyl benzoate is also one of the anti-parasitic agents which were previously used, but nowadays it is not used because of the safer and better safety profile and better treatment profile of permethrin and ivermectin. And in pregnancy conditions like pregnant women, or in conditions like very small children like in infants and neonates, precipitated 2 to 10% sulfur ointment can be used. Okay, now sulfur ointment only side effect is that it is quite messy and it stains your clothes and quite smelly also. So due to all these reasons, sulfur ointment is nowadays out of use, but still we can use it in conditions where permethrin cannot be given. So additional management, always we know that bed, linen, cloths, towels, everything should be washed after treatment, and non-washable items has to be stored inside a plastic bag for at least 1 week. So the mite will die within 1 week if it is not feeding. Okay, and proper vacuuming of upholstery and carpet should be there, because the mite might be staying there on the carpets or the beds or sofas and other places. So they should be properly vacuumed, and sun drying is one of the methods which should be applied, because the mite is not able to survive desiccation due to sun drying. So all these methods are there which helps in getting rid of community transmission. And usually in cases of community outbreak of scabies, prophylactic permethrin to all the family members or community members should be given, and oral ivermectin blanket treatment can be given to, suppose an outbreak is seen in some school hostel. So permethrin and ivermectin treatment given to all of the patients will give rise to decrease in the mite population. Okay, so these were all about scabies. Any questions? If you have, you can ask. Then we will deal with pediculosis, that is the louse or human louse. Okay, so I think 2 minutes are there. Any questions are there, you can ask. This question is there. No, see, mite is always, we know it is having a burrowing action. So even if your skin is intact, okay, the mite will attach. Usually just see the mite, actually see the diagram of the mite, because we are not discussing here about entomology. Basically we are discussing about the clinical part of the mite. So I have not discussed discussing about the entomology of the mite. So see here, this mite is having few of the small projections, okay, that is legs, okay, and it is having a small strong anchoring claw present over the frontal part, and this central two parts are the feeding probes. Okay, so what happens, the mite anchors to your skin by the claws, and then at night when you are lying down, when there is less movement, they will start burrowing into your skin. So essentially we can see this mite can invade intact skin also. So it is not at all required that mite should be present over the or should go inside the abraded skin only. It can go to the normal skin, attached to it, then burrow through it during its convenient time. Okay, any other questions you want to ask? Then we can you have any other questions, then we can pick up the other topic, that is pediculosis. Okay, I think no other questions. Antihistaminics, calamine lotion, these are all symptomatic treatment basically. Okay, we have to give antihistaminic and calamine lotion for symptomatic management, but basically treatment parts here is we are dealing basically with the condition. So as a disease, scabies, yes, we should give antihistaminics like levocetirizine or we should give calamine lotion, which gives a symptomatic relief. But treatment basically I was discussing about the antiparasitic agents. Okay, so whenever you get a questions over pedicular, sorry, scabies, obviously antihistaminics will be there. It is a part and parcel of any kind of itchy conditions over the skin. Okay, but treatment here basically involves how to eradicate and how to get rid of the mouse. So I have not discussed about total clinical profiles of how to deal with the itchy condition. Also, we use steroids in cases of hypersensitivity reaction, and antibiotics we can give in secondary infection. So those things we will better deal in our clinical classes, as we are dealing only with the scabies mite. So my treatment is basically focused toward getting rid of the scabies mite. So I think I will start with the next topic, that is pediculosis. Okay, now pediculosis, I think all of you are familiar. Pediculosis is nothing but human lice. Okay, now human lice is mostly seen in pediatric age group, because small children, they are not able to take care of their personal hygiene. Usually they play together in close proximity, and children are going to school, so they are getting in contact with each other. So the human lice can easily transform from one person to another person. So there are three different types of lice that are considered for importance in humans. That is, first is pediculosis humanus capitis or head louse. Then pediculus humanus corporis, as the name suggests, it is body louse. And third is thyrus or pubis, that is also known as pubic louse or crabe louse. So first we discuss about pediculus humanus capitis or head louse. Now first thing you have to remember, pediculus humanus is a obligate human ectoparasite. Okay, now they don't have animal carriers, but intermediate hosts can be present. Okay, it's like, suppose some pediculus, you are playing with some animal, and suppose some person is having a dog, and that person is having pediculus infection, or he is having lice. That lice can go to dog, and from that dog can come to you. But the life cycle of the pediculus or lice will only continue over once it comes to your body. The dog will only function as a intermediate carrier. It will not work as a host. So the reservoir is most commonly in humans, and children are most commonly infected by the pediculus capitis or head lice. Now you can see here some action graphic is there. This is the head louse. So when it comes to your, or suppose the eggs comes to your skin, the head louse will attach to the shaft of the hair. Now it will give rise to because of the ovulation, it will give rise to a louse. This louse will go down to your skin and it will start feeding. Now this louse usually takes 4 to 5 meals per day, up to 10 meals it can take, and after that the louse will start mating and it will start producing different eggs, which will again start attached to the hair shaft, and this hair cycle will again go on. Now here we can see, first you can see the head louse, it is attached strongly. So it has got different body parts. This is head, then there is thorax is there, then the lower part of the abdomen, and it has got different claws and proboscis, which is from which it is attaching to the hair shaft. Okay, in the first photo we can see different nits which are attached to the hair shaft. This is a high power microscopy showing the nits which are attached to the hair shaft. In low power or in normal photograph, it is seen as small different small white dandruff like globules present over the scalp. So we can confuse this condition with dandruff or psoriasis also. And here we can see the louse. Now difference between nits and dandruff is that when we try to remove the nit from the shaft of the hair, it is difficult because it is attached strongly to the shaft of the hair. But in cases of dry dandruff or in psoriasis, you can easily flake off. You can simply flake off, but the nits will not flake off. Second thing is that you can take out the nits and you can put it on microscopy and see the microscopic feature. And third thing, wherever nits are present, there will be presence of adult mites. Adult mites may be present if infection is too much. Here, like in this case, if the infestation is too much, you can see adult lice moving inside the hair. Now the life cycle of the mice, this is here. So egg lands up over the hair and it is called nit. Then louse emerges after 6 to 7 days. Then it is molts, first molt, second molt, third molt. And again female and male, they come out, they mate and give, female lays egg after 7 days. Okay, then these legs will attach to the hair shaft. Again the adult will come out, and after that the adult here, this adult will die after 30 to 35 days. And this life cycle goes on until unless it is interrupted by some kind of treatment. Okay, so these are all few characteristic features are there. First is size will be, this is all about the nits. Size will be 3 to 0.8 millimeter. Okay, and visible nits are always found close to the scalp because the nits have to feed on blood. So they will be close to skull because they can't move very freely because they don't have legs. And egg is tightly glued to the base of the hair shaft near the scalp with the chitin. So this gluing helps in preventing the nits to shed off by the normal movement of hair on the head. And eggs, they will usually hatch within 6 to 10 days. And only eggs which are deposited by inseminated females, lice will hatch. Okay, so the male will put the nits and female will by the inseminated females it will hatch, otherwise it will not hatch. Okay, now second stage is the nymph. Nymph is the smaller form or the intermediate forms of the adult. Okay, so they look like adults but they are small and immature, and they will first stage, second stage and third stage. So here you can see different stages of nymph. And nymphs usually don't move, they will remain attached to the head wherever they are. And newly hatched nymph will crawl and seek a place to feed immediately because they are rapidly growing, so they need to attach. Okay, and the stage is usually around 2 weeks. Okay, 1 to 2 weeks, then it will go into formation of adults. Now adults, here we can see a strong microscope features. They have 3 abdominal segments, they have short antennae with 4 segments. Okay, all these things are more importantly of entomobiological point of view rather than clinical point of view. But one thing I wanted to point out, here we can see strong claw. Okay, short stubby powerful claw. These claws are used to grasp the hair shaft so that the adult will not fall off, so that the lice will not fall off from the head. Okay, now next we go to the body louse. Okay, now human louse and body louse, the difference is not much. Few differences are there, that is number of eggs. Okay, and body louse is slightly longer, the human head louse is slightly shorter, it has have little bit stubby appearance. Okay, and body louse, it has got a longer lifespan rather than the head louse. Head louse has got 30 to 35 days whereas it is 60 days. Okay, now body louse, they can survive up to 1 month, 1 week after getting separated from human host and without feeding. And most importantly, we have to remember the body louse is carrier for most importantly trench fever, relapsing fever, epidemic typhus. So these 3 fevers, that is TRE, trench fever, relapsing fever and epidemic typhus, all are again caused by rickettsial. These are all rickettsial infection as you have studied in your community medicine classes. So trench fever, that is caused by Roschelmania quintana, the body louse is carrier of trench fever. relapsing fever, or that is Borrelia recurrentis. It is again caused by, transmitted by body louse. An epidemic typhus caused by rickettsia. So all these three different kind of diseases are transmitted by body louse. So body louse is a important vector for many rickettsial vector borne diseases. So if somebody is having body louse infestations with fever and all that, you strongly suspect either relapsing fever or typhus. Okay, then pityriasis pubis or pubic louse. Now, pubic louse is associated with poor hygienic condition. Okay, mostly seen in psychiatric patients, critically ill patients who are bed bound and who are not able to move properly. And pubic louse, as such, we think that it is a commensal organism. They don't have any specific symptoms. They have a very sedentary life, and they can be transmitted during sexual contact. So if pubic lice is present, it can be an indicator of recent sexual contact. Okay, so distinguishing features are again the life cycle and all that, is that duration of the life cycle is very slow, around 90 days. So 30 to 35 days for body louse, 30 to 35 for head louse, 60 days for body louse, and around 90 days for pubic louse. Apart from it, the size and shape of the organism is also very small. It is, as compared to the body louse and the head louse, the organism is smaller in size. And other legs are very stout, and they have continuously. Okay, and here we can see pediculosis humans. So commonly found man. So crab louse, you can see the size is much smaller. The claws are much longer. Okay, because of scanty body hair, pubic hair, they have to attach very strongly. And this thorax or abdominal segment are usually not as elongated as in cases of body and head louse. It is somewhat shorter, but it has got a broad body segment. Here the broadness is not there. Now, treatment of louse, most importantly, again we know it is ectoparasite, so treatment is mostly antiparasitic agents, mostly organophosphorus or antiparasitic neurotoxic poisons like permethrin. So permethrin shampoo we can give, we can ask the patient to apply for 7 to 10 minutes, then wash off, and then we have to remove the nits with a tightly packed comb so that nits are not attached to the hair shaft, so they can't give rise to a secondary attack. And repeat application is always advisable. Apart from it, oral ivermectin can be given. Oral ivermectin is important because it has got a significant antiparasitic activity, and single dose of ivermectin is supposed to be killing all nits and mites. It will kill the nits also, whereas permethrin will only kill the adult, because the mites are nits which are attached are not easily penetrated by permethrin. So ivermectin we can give, it will kill the nits and the mites both. And also ivermectin shampoo is also available. Gamma benzene hexachloride 2% lotion is also sometimes used, but nowadays it is mostly out of use. And general hygiene, like keeping hair short, avoiding close contact, washing hair frequently with shampoo, using a hot water to wash hair will also kill the adult nits and mites. Okay, even shaving head in cases of severe infestation can also be done. So these were few of the ectoparasitic infestations present commonly seen in human skin. So I think we have 10 to 15 minutes. Okay, so we can discuss some questions. Okay, so first important thing is that I want to ask basically what is the mechanism action of permethrin. Okay, I think you have all read scabies and pediculosis well in before. So what is the mechanism action of permethrin? Okay, so if you know the answer, you can just type and send to me don't search it on internet because it will not help you. If you don't know, we will discuss about the mechanism of action of permethrin. Okay, so permethrin is basically a neurotoxic agent. Now permethrin, how it is acting? So usually permethrin has got very poor blood brain barrier penetration. In human body, permethrin is unable to penetrate blood brain barrier. Okay, so what it is happening, permethrin is percolating through the mites or through the louse or lice skin, and it is going inside its nervous system and it is blocking the which receptor? That is acetylcholine receptors. Okay, so acetylcholine receptor blocking leads to difficulty in respiration in mites. So there is paralysis, mice is paralyzed. Now the problem with each mite or the pediculus capitis is paralyzed. So the problem with permethrin is always a repeat application is advised, because repeat application is advised here by sodium potassium channel blockade. It is blocking the acetylcholine receptor. Now repeat application is advised because it will not act over the eggs, because it will not penetrate the eggs. Okay, now second drug is, what is the role of cotrimoxazole in pediculosis? What is the role of cotrimoxazole in pediculosis? So if you have any idea, you can tell me, we can discuss it. So okay, very good. Secondary infection, if secondary infection is not present, then I have not asked that what is the role in secondary infection, because we can always give other antibiotics, better antibiotics like amoxiclav, or we can give amoxicillin, or we can give cephalosporin in cases of secondary infection. But cotrimoxazole specifically, what is the role of cotrimoxazole in pediculosis, and specifically pediculosis, not even mite? Okay, pediculosis rarely you will find secondary infections. Okay, so we will discuss it. If you have any answers, you can tell me. Now second drug is ivermectin. Ivermectin has got a specific advantage that it penetrates all the skin barriers, even the ovas and the nets. Okay, so what happens if when it penetrates the ovas and the eggs, it will go inside it. So it will cause a neurotoxic irreversible death. Second is that it has got a both larvicidal as well as miticidal action. So it will keep the larva and mite. So clearance rate with ivermectin is better as compared to permethrin. But as such, we should not give a single drug, because the mites are known to produce resistance against various anti-parasitic agents. So combination therapy is always advised in comparison to single therapy or monotherapy. Now discussing about role of cotrimoxazole, it has been seen that there is presence of commensal organism in the gastrointestinal system of the pediculus capitis. Okay, the pediculus capitis has some microorganism present in their intestinal or gastrointestinal system. So when we give cotrimoxazole, the bacteria which is present inside the pediculus capitis gastrointestinal tract, they are highly sensitive to cotrimoxazole. So if you give cotrimoxazole to person suffering with pediculus capitis or head louse, the gut bacteria will die out, and due to the death of the gut bacteria, the pediculus capitis will not be able to carry on its own metabolism basically, or digestion. Even if they take the blood meal, they will not able to sustain the digestion and they will die. So this is one of the conditions where an antibiotic has got a not direct miticidal action, but instead it is acting on a different mechanism, that it is killing the gut bacteria, so making viability of or making the survivability of the head louse difficult. So along with, if some child is coming with pedicular scapitis, that is head louse with secondary infection, you should always give cotrimoxazole rather than giving other drugs, because obviously cotrimoxazole will cover secondary infection, but it will also cover the commensal bacteria or the gut bacteria of pedicular scapitis, and it will help leading to faster clearance of the organisms. Okay, any questions, any doubts? Any questions, any doubts? Okay, we will have a MCQ based questions and answers for skin and appendages. I will share it to you all via Google Forms. Okay, it will be a single choice and it can be also multiple choice questions. Okay, so like it may be only answer may be A, answer may be AB, answer may be ABCD also. So all of these can also be there. So multiple choice questions usually you will have around some 25 questions. Okay, 25 questions. In 25 questions, around 10 questions will be on skin and its anatomy. Then 10 questions will be on hair and nail, and 5 questions will be on your appendageal structures like sebaceous gland and all that. So by mostly tomorrow or mostly by Monday you will get your assessment. So if you have any doubts regarding these two topics, you can ask. Other 3 minutes are there. Otherwise I will close the portal by 12:55 p.m. Okay, any doubts you can ask, or any thing which you were not able to understand, we can discuss and elaborate on that.